message. Serendipity means something good and unexpected. Awesome. So we can go ahead and lock the room down as far as close out any individuals who have their mics open, and we can move forward. Well, this morning is a beautiful morning, and I woke up a little earlier than normally this morning. I was just lying there in the bed and just got quiet, and I just heard the Spirit say to me, speak to them this morning on exceedingly abundantly above. And you know, I kind of had something else I wanted to share with you this morning, but that's what serendipity is. Serendipity Sunday is all about. It's not so much of me having a planned message as to be available to deliver your mail, which is my mail, our mail on this morning. And so this morning's scripture is found in the book of Ephesians. If you have a Bible, you can turn it. If not, you can just stay with me on this morning as we move forward. Let me move my screen to, there you go. Awesome. That way I see you guys on the side there and I can make sure that everything is well. So this morning, if the scripture will come from Ephesians chapter 3. So, and I'm going to read it from the New International Version. And I'm going to pick up in verse 14. This is Paul writing to the church at Ephesus. He says, "For this reason, I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches, he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with the Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide and long and how high and deep is the love of Christ. And to know his love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God." Now, this is the part of this particular set of scriptures that I really resonate with, and it's one of my favorite scriptures. And it goes on to say, "Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we can ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen." So that's that scripture given to you in the New International Version. I'm going to bring it forward in just the King James Version this morning also. It says, when you go to the King James Version, let me go there quickly. It says in King James Version, "Now to him who is able to do exceedingly." I love that word exceedingly. Exceedingly means more than. And what I'm hearing in the Spirit this morning is too many of us are playing small with God. When you look at your prayers, you are only praying inside of circumstances. You're praying inside of what you are capable of doing. You're asking for things that you can see yourself receiving solely on what you can do to get them, but you're playing small. And I like the scripture because it says, "Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask." Now that word "ask" is a interesting word. When you look it up in the Greek, it's ateo, and it means to decree. So God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above anything you may decree. So many times we decree a thing from the place of our understanding. We decree a thing from our place of what is showing up. And so what we have to understand is when we decree something solely based on what we can see is not taking in consideration what's coming in the very next moment. It's decreeing something based on something that has been. And even though it's showing up right now, only reason it keeps showing up in our future is because we keep rehearsing it. But in order to erase that, first we have to come into a realization that we can have anything we desire. the Bible is explicit and it says, you have not because you ask not. And then it goes on in that same scripture that when you do ask, you ask amiss. I mean, that means like you ask the wrong thing. You miss the mark. You under ask or you over ask, or you asking the thing that is not in alignment with God's highest and greatest good for you. When we are operating as sons and daughters of God, we must always be conscious of what is its will. And when we are aware of what its will or God's source's will is for us, then we really should be asking for things that are in alignment with it. But the reality is we spend a lot of time asking when we don't have to ask, asking from the place of petitioning. Now, there's a place of petitioning that is because I don't see it, I don't have it, I'm requesting it. But then there's a place of asking, which is not a petition, but it's really a declaration. And sons, as ambassadors, as sons and daughters of God, we need to practice more the declarative statements versus the statements of requests. And I say that because when you understand this scripture, in verse 20, it says, now to him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all. So all means all. It's inclusive. It means everything. All is just defines any possibility that can exist. It's able to do exceedingly abundantly, not only exceedingly, but abundantly. And that's an interesting stringing together of two words, exceedingly and abundantly. Well, exceedingly can to me means that it's beyond what you can comprehend or what you perceived that you're able to receive. Okay. But then abundantly says even beyond that in size, in overflow, in more than enough. So God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think. That's the focus this morning. What we ask and what we think. Asking has two dimensions to it. There's the asking in the sense of request, and there's the asking in this truest form of the scripture as declarative. Now, to make a declaration assumes that you know that you are aware of the power you have. And one of the things that I've come to realize for the body of Christ is the unknowingness that is prevalent of the power that each of us have. For there is clearly a power that's greater than all of us that is existence in the world today. But there's a power that is not only greater than us in the world, but that very same power resides in us. And so if we can wrap our minds, our brains, our realization around that God dwells in us. God is the power that is greater than us. And the us is the ego self. The us is your human self. But when you allow your container to be filled with God, and you do not grieve the Holy Spirit. So we talked yesterday, I kind of mentioned it when I was talking about our letting our light shine. And just as you have a 100 watt bulb, that the greatest that bulb could shine based on its capacity is 100 watts. And so each of us have a capacity to shine inside of, but we can never reach that capacity unless we totally realize that the power to shine is found in recognizing that the power is in us. And that power really is us, but not independent of source, but interdependent. And so when you hear me say every time we talk that there's a power greater than you that's available to you, a power that resides in you, and here's the killer, and you can use it. And so when we learn how to tune in, tap into the power and become one with the power, then we can do all things. Now, in agreement with this scripture, it tells us that God can do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask. And so we need to shift our relationship with God from that of always asking or petitioning to realizing that God is in us, working or looking to work through us, as us. And many times we're so focused on what is going on in our lives, we're preoccupied with the contrast, because the contrast is showing up to show you you can do something about it. You don't have to settle. And that's what I hear with this word exceeding this morning. As we move into this new year, we actually are moving into the spring of this year, which is March. We move in, I think, March 21st. We move into the spring of this year, which is the new year. This represents when things are new. Things have died. The December, December 21st, we moved into the winter solstice. Prior to that, we was in the fall season. Fall was a time of things falling away. Things appear to be dying. Then December, we move into the winter and things appear to be dormant. And then we move into that part of the year where things all of a sudden begin to come alive. It's like you walk outside and the grass that was brown is all of a sudden green. The tree that was barren is also all of a sudden bearing, budding with whatever's going to come forth on that tree. And the same for you today in your life. Get ready, I hear the Lord saying. I hear the Spirit saying. So this morning, my conversation is kind of prophetic and not just a teaching, but I'm speaking something into you that I believe was downloaded into me to tell you to get ready that God desires to do exceedingly abundantly above anything you can ask. So what that means, you can stop asking. For the next week, let's try not to ask, or let's attempt or to be mindful that we needn't ask. Now, I'm talking about, when I say ask, I'm not talking about decreeing, because between now and the next time we meet, you're going to get a download. You're going to get an inclination. You're going to get an aha. You're going to get a revelatory idea, a revealing idea that you hadn't thought about. It didn't come from you. And you're going to know, wow, where did that come from? And so now you begin to decree that, okay? The decreeing of something is saying, I'm in alignment with that. And like Christ said, I only do that which I see or hear my Father doing. So when we decree something, it should be consistent with what we have seen or heard spoken to us. And usually it comes in a way of a dream. Now, a dream doesn't have to be only exclusively when you're lying dormant on your bed. You can have a daydream. You can have the, you're sitting there and you move into this state of, you're in between the conscious state and an unconscious state. And all of a sudden you hear something, you see something, it has you captivated. And what is happening is you hit a sweet spot where you're getting a download. And now what you do with that download is important. You need to begin to decree that it is what it is. What you have seen in heaven can be done on earth. So there's nothing that is loosed in the earth except it is first loosed in heaven. Just as well, there's nothing that is bound in the earth except first we bind it in heaven. So if there's some things that you are attempting, would like to see cease and desist, go before God. And God will let you know, source will let you know, the thing that you're going through, the season is over. And I hear it right now for many of you all who you've been in a season of you feel like you're on hold, or you're not even going through anything bad. It's just life appears to be mundane, or it appears that you're getting a repeat of another season. Pump your brakes, hold your horses. And I stopped by to tell you this morning that this is the season. Matter of fact, this is the day. The word says a day is as a thousand years to the Lord. So this is the day that the Lord has made. You should rejoice And you should be glad in it because the messenger is bringing you a message that says for you, says to you that this is the day you've been waiting for. So when you get the download, you want to decree. You want your words to align with what you see. You don't bring it into this reality by asking for it. You bring it into the reality by decreeing it as such. And then you also cultivate it by acting as if it is, not as if it will be. So example, I'm purchasing a home, a condo. And so I'm in the place of running through my mind what I want to be placed where. So I find myself doing a lot of imagining, particularly when I begin to have doubt run through my mind. You know, doubt runs through when you least expect it. And sometimes it's residual from a season in your life when you perhaps weren't in abundance and you were being very frugal. And now you are attempting to do something great, but now you are thinking about what has been. You got to be careful how when doubt runs through your mind. Sometimes doubt is a contract to see if you're really ready, to see if you trust and believe. No, trust and know. You could believe anything, but the things you know are the things that make a difference in your life. And so as I sit and I meditate throughout my day, I will just think about the place. I've taken pictures, and sometimes I'll go back to my phone and I'll look at them. Sometimes I'll just imagine in my mind's eye what it's like to walk into the space, what I want on this wall, all of those things. So what I'm doing is cultivating as if it already is. And so what happens is those things begin to appear, show up. Those things begin to show up. You know, you had an image in your mind for pictures on this wall. You find pictures. They find you. So in this scripture, it talks about asking. And there's two levels to asking. And I want you to be mindful of that. Two types of asking. There's the prayer of requests. And I'm saying that as believers in relationship with God, you don't have to be making prayers of requests. Now, when you were a child, when you were a baby, did you have to ask? Matter of fact, you couldn't even ask. Maybe if you cried, it let your mom know that you need to be attended to, before you, when you were a baby, maybe you needed to be nourished, or maybe you needed your diaper changed. So you would cry. It was just to acknowledge. And sometimes we think we have to do the same thing with God. God, we don't have to cry out to God. We don't have to bring it to God's attention. Why? Because God is not out there. God is right here, right now with you. When you come into the realization that God is in you, waiting to operate as you, through you, then you know it's an ever-present presence. Let me say that again. God, source, is an ever-present presence, a present presence of God, always with you. He says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So when we have the realization that God is in us, working through us, walking with us, we don't have a need to petition it for anything. It knows. Matter of fact, it knows before you know. That's why if we can get comfortable in trusting it, we can say yes to its will. With the realization that God desires to give you the desires of your heart. God desires to be a major player in your life as you go through this life that you have chose to come and experience. It desires to be part of that experience. And if you want that experience to be grand, you will capture scriptures like this: whom God calls, he equips. So whatever God has commissioned you to do, he equips you. if you're doing the work of the kingdom, the work of God, of source, God provides the resources. Many of you got a grand idea, a great idea, a God idea, not just a good idea, but you got the right idea. But you have a tendency to slip into your reasoning mind or your reasoning self, and you find that there's no way I can do that based on what I've been, based on what I have, based on your perceived limitations. But the word says there is no failure in God or with God. So anything you do with God, you are assured to have great success. Now, so one part of that is asking in the way of petitioning. The second part of asking is asking in the way of decreeing. Now, that is a sweet spot to stay with. If you look in Deuteronomy, it says, you shall decree a thing and it shall be. Not will be. It is. And so the reality is that we have to watch what we speak. Because when we speak a word in a definite, in a declarative way, and that word is not what we really want to experience or express, the universe don't know when you're joking or when you're misstepping. So you got to be conscious. That's why the scriptures tells us to put a guard, to bridle our tongues. Psalms tells us to let a centurion stand watch over our lips, that we don't speak prematurely, or we don't put something out there that we don't want to experience. And the second part of this scripture that I really wanted to focus on is the word think. It says, now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask. So we got asking out the way, decreeing out the way, or think. Now that's where the game of life is played. Source can do abundantly, exceedingly beyond what you think you can do. Many times our thinking is limited to what we've thought. And what those thoughts have produced has us captive to what is showing up in our lives. And sometimes it's not only what we are thinking, but it what we allow to be inside of our thinking cap, what we give our attention to. And so you have to be very careful that you don't allow what is going on in the earth realm at any given time to become a barrier, or that you filter what you want or what you desire or what God says it wants to do to you or through you through this filter. And here's the filter: what is really going on in reality? Okay, the banks are not giving loans. Okay. That may be true. That may be a truth, but it's maybe a personal truth, but it's not a universal truth. And even if the bank's not giving loans, why are you limiting what source desires to do for you through this one avenue? I remember when I first came into ministry and I answered the call to the pastorate, one of the conditions that I had was, or the conversations that I had with God, that I believe that if he was calling me into ministry, that I wasn't being called to move into a storefront. That's just dropped in my spirit. And so I had this conversation with God. And in little or no time, within 3 months of answering the call, we had found an actual church. And so I followed the spirit. I went in. And we ended up renting the facility. When they weren't there, we were there, and I treated it as though it was mine. I mean, I adhered to the time frames they'd given us. We always left the place better than we received it. Treated it like it was mine. But I say that to say that I never went into the ministry or started the church with the expectation that I must get a building fund. And that's what many of us do. Anytime we want to do something and we don't have it at our disposal, we start either, most churches will say, I'm going to get a building fund. But on a personal level, if you want to go on a vacation, the first thing you do is start counting your pennies. And then you'll be, or counting, looking at your bank account, look at what is committed to what and what's available, and then decide on how you can get that money or get the bag, as the kids say. But you don't have to do that. You don't have to focus on the middle piece, because it's God's to do, not you. All you have to do, if you get it in your spirit right now that you believe you're supposed to be on a vacation this year, don't do like everybody else. Don't look at how much money you have, how much you believe is going to cost, subtract the what you have from what it's going to cost, and get a bottom line, and then say, how can I? You don't even have to do any of that. And that's not only for taking a vacation, taking a class, anything you desire, anything that you believe has been dropped in on you as God's desire for you. The word of God says, the Lord is your shepherd. The law is your shepherd, and you shall not want. If God has dropped something on you, you are not wanting for it, meaning you shall not lack. You will get it. Matter of fact, let me reframe that. The moment God drops it on you, you have it. And if you can really conceptualize that, when I receive it in the spirit, I have it in the most important place. Because things received in the unseen ultimately manifest in the seen realm. We have to get rid of all of this. We have to get rid of the time lapse. We got to get rid of the past, which is, or even the present that is measured in time of minutes, second minutes, hours, days, months, years. We have to get rid of that concept when you're dealing with source, when you're dealing with your life. You have to be present to right here, right now. Okay, so the moment God drops it on you, you have it. Now, it will take some time perhaps for the natural realm to align itself to drop that thing in on you. Some of you are not really ready to receive what it is that God wants to drop in on you. Because maybe it wants to drop something in on you right now, right here, but you are surrounded by, you got too many people involved in your life. Remember Abraham, he said, get away from your circle. Now, I'm not saying that any of you need to get away from your circle, but you have to be conscious of this. Sometimes when God drops something on you, it's not for those who are around you. And if you are not conscious of that, and you are accustomed to being to them what God desires to be to them, then you will be blocking your own blessing. Because if God drops X amount of dollars on you today for you to do this, but because you got a cousin or a friend or someone who appears to be in need, and then you take it upon yourself to take that which was given to you to do something else and to help someone else, you got to be very careful. That's why you got to walk in the spirit always. When you get a blessing, you have to know how much of that blessing is for you. And if there's a portion, because remember, God does exceed abundantly above. So there may be a portion in the overflow that you can help someone else. That's why I tell you, get clear on what you want. So when, and you may, okay, you get clear on what you want. And so when it shows up, you know, you can line out that it's shown up. So let's say you want, the number one thing on your list is to purchase a car. You don't know how it's going to come, but all of a sudden you get some way, somehow, you get a check for a large sum of money. If you are not clear on what it is you want, then immediate desires can begin to come forth, and you find yourself spending that which was sent to you to get that car on other things. Now it looks like you got to pay this bill by this day. So that's where the contrast begins to show up and the testing is. And here's the test. When you get what, when what you have desired shows up, will you receive it and do what you should be doing with it? Or do you let the cares of this world, what is going on right now, what is showing up, dictate what you do with what you should, what you have received, and what you should be doing with it? I don't know why I went down that path, but I believe I went down that path because there's someone tuned in, tapped in right now, that a blessing is on the way, but be clear that you do what you need to do with that blessing. You guys are going to have some competing things, but you want to take what comes to you and take care of first things first. That's important. Now, I like this. He says he can do exceedingly above all that we ask or think. Your thoughts. When you say, what are you asking for? I mean, what is it that you desire? Okay, let's say somebody might be desiring a car. Someone may be desiring a home. Someone may be desiring just employment. And that's a good point right there. As you know, I work for the VA, and a small part of my job is I work with veterans. I have a small caseload of veterans who come to me, and they are in between jobs or they have no jobs. And some of them have been in a chronic situation without jobs for a long time. And the first question I'll ask them, what type of job do you want? The most frequent response is, I just want a job. I'll take anything. Anything is never satisfying. You know, that's why, like, if you give a gift to some people say, it's the thought that count, or the fact that I gave you this. No. If you really want to be excited in life, find out what will excite you. And that even coming to a job, have an idea of what things do you enjoy doing? What would you be okay with going to a place of employment and doing it for 40 hours a week? What things would you even do for little or no money? That's not to say that you will extend yourself for employment and not get paid top dollar, but I'm saying first be clear on what would you enjoy doing? Because here's the truth of the matter. The job that you take on isn't the primary reason of taking on that job as a believer, isn't necessarily for the income that it brings in, but it for the relationships that we will engage in on that job. We are ambassadors. When we go to a place of employment, we're there to do a job. But in the course of doing the job, people are observing you. Relationships are being established. And many times you are the message that is being sent to that person on the job. That isn't to say that you're supposed to be breaking the scriptures out, quoting scriptures, doing all. No, you live out the kingdom principles. And in the course of time, you'll get the opportunity to share, and you'll come to the realization why you are on that job. Now, with every job, there comes compensation. But the primary reason you are on the job, because it's part of your assignment. Know that. Now, it's great to be on an assignment and get due compensation for it. But the reality of, as believers, we should be living far above what we make. Hear me what I just said. You should not be living, this should not be made a comment made by believers. I'm living within my means. Now, there's two sides to that. Living within my means is living within what I'm capable of doing. So I'll give you that. But there's another piece of that is living your means come to a stop. But now I'm living inside of the kingdom. I'm living as an ambassador. That's where you get more than, you live a life that is greater than the 40 hour or the salary that you put in. I've had amazing life. I've lived some great places. I've driven some nice cars. I've been all over the world. But when I look on paper, I have lived beyond my means and I'm not even in debt. Okay. Matter of fact, one of the challenges, it wasn't a challenge, but one of the concerns was I didn't have any credit lines when I went to get to purchase the home besides my car. See how things worked? 7 months ago, 8 months ago, I purchased a car. And in purchasing the car, I had no clue that I was going to be purchasing a home or a place that I'll call my own. Because I'm in Missouri. No, I'm joking with you. So I'm in Missouri. And I finally got to the place where I says, this is my assignment and I'll accept it. And so where I am, the kingdom is. Even though there's poverty all around me, I don't have to live inside of that. So I pulled down the kingdom into St. Louis. And so I found this place. And here's the point I was making. If you just live your life inside of your means, you're not going to be happy. But when you can come to the realization that source is your resource and that you don't have to labor, the word of God says, labor not to get wealth. Now, wealth is not money. Wealth is the vibration of living in a great place. Wealth is the vibration of having health. Wealth is the vibration of more than enough. He says that you don't labor to get that. And too many of us are laboring. So some of you may not be laboring through a job, but you're laboring in your mind. You're laboring in your thought. And so part of the conversation this morning is for those of you who have been working the universal principles, God is saying to you to take your attention off that thing, pump your brakes, go out and take a walk. Put your focus on something else. Why? Because it's already done. When your focus needs to come back to that thing you desire, it'll come back to it. But until something shows up that says you need to attend to it, move on to the next thing. And it's not moving on to the next thing, bigger or better thing. It's just being present to right here, right now. Get out the house. Go for a walk in the park. Go buy some ice cream. Go to the gym. Take your attention off of the thing that you are intending. Because the more you give an intention to that or attempt to cultivate that, you are also sending a signal that you don't trust God, source, that you got to do it. So I like the scripture. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, here it is, according to the power that works in us, in you, in me. Say that. According to the power that works in me. A couple people didn't say it, so let's try it one more time. According to the power that works in me. So here's a realization I want you to come into today. That there's a power greater than you, a power that is available to you, a power that is inside of you, and it's a power that you can use. Because once you realize that there's a power greater than you that's at work in you, all those things that I stated beforehand, now God can do them. And it says, to him be the glory in the church. You are the church by Christ, meaning your consciousness, your Christ consciousness, your awareness of the mind of God resides in you, a portion of it, okay? And it ends with, to all generations, forever and ever, amen. So let me recapitulate. Let me sum it all up, what I'm saying to you. Take a break. Allow the thing that you desire to manifest, to come forward. You don't have to labor for it. You don't have to be fixated on it. The more you are thinking about it, the reality of it is you're not trusting the process. You're not at a place of knowing it is done. You're not at the place of, and so it is. That's what I want to get you to. So for some of you all, I hear the Spirit saying, you've been playing small. You've been dissatisfied because you've only been asking for those things that just keep you in the game. God says, now it's time to show up grand. It's time to show up great. And it's not just tied to a conversation of materialism. I'm talking about what God has called you to do. It's time for you to be the voice. Like this week, I just came into the realization, hey, I've been studying everybody else's stuff. I've been promoting everybody else's thoughts. But God has given me something that I call now thought. You know, I've been part of the new thought churches. And I began to study their history, and I find there's limitations therein. And so here we are in 2021 on the cusp of the age of Aquarius. It's time for a new conversation to come forward. So now thought has to do with the reality of there is no need to be concerned about what has been or what will be or projecting out into the future, but stay present to what do I need to deal with right now, right here, right now. Because how you deal with the right here, right now dictates what we call tomorrow will be. There's never a tomorrow. There's always today. There's always the present moment. So I want you always to be present to its presence. I want you to be present to your presence, your ability to change this moment called now. And don't always be so quick to want to change something, but to be in a place of gratitude, to be okay with where you are today. And know that tomorrow will take care of itself. That's my word for you this morning. God desires to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you can ask or think according to the power that works in you. Awesome. Thank you. Well, that wraps up this morning's message. Let me take a moment to make a couple of announcements. First of all, I would hope that you would join me Monday through Friday at 6 a.m. for our morning meditation, 6 a.m. to 6:15. If you want to know more about it, if you go into the, if you're looking in the chat, the website is www.theplaceofpossibilities.com. Or if you on the live, looking down in the feed, you'll see the website is there. When you click on the website, you go to morning meditation, and it'll tell you the phone number to dial in. Tuesday nights. Tuesday is Transformation Tuesdays. This Tuesday, I'm dealing with the Kemetic Tree of Life. Now, many of you are aware of the Kabbalah, the Jewish mystical system. They have a Tree of Life. And many of you may not even be aware of that. But we heard about the two trees in the garden, the tree of knowledge and good and evil, and the tree of knowledge of knowledge of good and evil. So there's two trees that was in the garden. So we're going to talk about that. It's the tree of life. We're going to talk about the tree of life this Tuesday. And I'm going to contrast the Jewish or the Kabbalah tree of life, which is the tree of life that the Jews received while they were in Egypt or bondage or in Kemet. And then I'm going to contrast that against the Nile Valley civilization's tree of life. And then you're going to see something. The tree of life is about transformation, moving up the tree. Okay. Too many of us are dealing with the tree on the lower aspects, the low hanging fruit. Too many of you are going through life just picking the fruit that you can easily reach up and get. But the sweetest fruit, the best fruit you can get, may require you to climb the tree, may require you to stand on the ladder. So that's Tuesday night. So make sure you're involved with Transformation Tuesday. Then on Saturday, every Saturday, we have Saturday school. Yes, Saturday school, and we're inside of a 12-week series. I'm dealing with the science of mind, helping you understand that new thought, and also introduce you into now thought, introduce you to the Kemetic influence of all of that. Not just going with contemporary history, but taking it back to where all this stuff came from. So I encourage you to join in. Lastly, we always make a space for you to contribute to this ministry, not because we have a need, not because Greg is having agreed that you could satisfy, but we offer an opportunity for you to sow a seed. Because if you really are finding value in your time with me, Just as if you go to a restaurant and you find value in that restaurant, you normally tip the waiter. Okay, but we don't tip the speaker. We don't tip source. What we do is return back to source a portion of what it has given us. Now, how do we return it? We sow it into a good work, a good person. And when you sow it into a good place, then you get a return on your giving. So if you want to be a blessing to this ministry this morning, you can also go in the link and hit the tab that says giving, and you can give by way of PayPal, you can give by way of text to give, you can give by way of the Cash App, or you can give by way of our tithing app that we have there. So I want to thank all of you who have continued to support the ministry, whatever role you have. Those of you who have given sporadically, we thank you for that also. So so giving is not about the receiver as much as it is about the giver. All right, V, let us go over to the back room and see if there's any questions or anything I can address before we wrap up this morning.
Absolutely. Great message this morning, Greg. I just dropped the link for giving in both the Facebook comment section and here in our chat box here on Zoom. So we appreciate your giving to the ministry. It is definitely about the giver. Absolutely. So we don't have any comment. I mean, any questions per se, but some really good comments on Facebook. So let's tune in. From Dorothy Robertson, she commented, "Believe in that which you can't see. The universe holds many things." Can you speak to that?
Yes, I like that. She said, "Believe in that which you can't see." So let's deal with the concept of none, N-U-N, zilch, zero. That is the state, what we call in the science of mind, the field, the unseen state, which is called none. Okay, none means because everything that is necessary for it to become something is out there. And so what we have to understand is there's nothing new under the sun. Everything that ever manifests, every idea that will go from the unseen to the seen already is in existence. Now, on a micro level, for you, that means the thing that you desire, that you see in your mind's eye, will come into the earth realm if you operate inside of the proper practices and principles, if you don't abort it. Sometimes we abort what is coming to us by, you ever been on a site and it says, while this is processing, don't hit the back key. And sometimes we are hitting the back key when we are asking for the thing that we have already asked for again. So in relation to what Dorothy is saying, which we resonate, is that everything already exists. So the beauty of that is the thing you desire already exists. You have to know how to get it from there to here. It's in a warehouse somewhere. You just have to place the requisition and it'll come to you. Awesome.
I love that. We had great energy this morning from Facebook. Talanda Hughes repeated you according to the power that works in me. So that resonated with people and I'm happy to see that. We also had somebody that said, Talanda Hughes here on Facebook, "I decree all is provided exceedingly abundantly above all I can ask for and think." Did you want to comment and speak to that before I then make my comment?
So she made a declaration that she affirmed the truth that all is provided. Now, in the old church, we call God Jehovah Jireh, meaning God is my provider. She's one of my friends out on the West Coast, and she's also a coach. And so she understands the principles and she's practicing it. I observe it. She's killing it out there on the West Coast. From like me, she's from the west side of Chicago, and she's hit it on the head. So when you can decree, that is, I'm not asking for it, but I'm just saying God got me. Source has me. What I desire is looking for me. What I'm looking for is looking for me. Come on now. And so it just puts you at an ease. It shows up when it shows up.
Yes. Absolutely. Something I want to speak to before we wrap up, and I actually put this in our chat box here on Zoom, is your statement that God lives within us. That is powerful. Can we talk about that and what you mean by God lives within us?
Okay, so here's the reality. too many of us through religion. The word religion means to tie to. We've been bound to the idea that God is out there. And that has been reinforced by being taught that you are a sinner, saved by grace, that you were born in sin. So you came into the world in sin, that makes you a sinner. And so you can't wrap your mind around how could something as great, as holy, as pure, as source, as God reside in a container that is a sinner. So we have to reformat the word sin. The word sin is a, in its original context, was a archery, a word that was used in archery. When you sin, that meant that you pull the arrow back and you let it go and it hit the target, but not on the mark. So that was a sin. When you hit a bullseye, you were on point. So what we want to come to the realization of is sin is simply this: we missed the mark. But we have to also understand that there's a thing called grace, God's redemptive act concerning everyone, G-R-A-C-E, God's redemptive act concerning everyone. So when we buy into the conversation of Christianity, we say the primary purpose of Christ's coming was that it was the sacrifice that was necessary, that you don't have to do any work to be in right standing with God. But the reality is, even without Christ's coming, we should realize this: we're created in his image, after his likeness, and we have ability because of it being in us. So we are in his image, after his likeness, and God lives in us. I am the Father, and the Father is in me. You are my microcosm. You're not all God. You are a spark of God. Okay? And whether or not you are good or bad, whether or not you cussing, fussing, fighting, sleeping around, drinking, whatever you would consider low vibrational activity, God is still in you. That's what the scripture says. Grieve not the holy essence. I know it says Holy Spirit. That's in you. Because when you grieve it, now the power within you cannot work with the fullness that it can work with. You're not being punished. You're just cutting down your capacities to shine. That makes sense?
It makes so much sense. Wonderful. We have a hand up from Courtney Bates. Courtney, okay. I just unmuted you. So please, good morning. Go for it.
Good morning. Thank you. I just want to say this message was really powerful and I'm really thankful for the message. I woke up this morning, you know, there was something that I was kind of waiting for to happen. And I kind of, you know, I would hear in my mind, you know, I'm a lady in waiting, but I'm like, am I really? And is this thing not coming forth because of me? Is it me, or do I really feel like it's being withheld from me? And I realized that when Spirit put the power back in my hand, I'm the one that felt the unreadiness. I'm the one that felt like I wanted to get everything ready and I wanted to be a certain way and I wanted to have things a certain way before this thing would show up. And so it just, I realized that, you know, it's not Spirit withholding, it's me. And you know, it was impressed upon me, go ahead and say what you want, what you intend. And this message was a perfect reminder of that, is that, you know, I don't think I've asked or intended for this and I didn't feel like I could, but now all of a sudden I know that I can. And I just appreciate the fact that you reminded me that I can decree it, I can declare it, and then take my hands off of it and allow it to come forth. So I just really appreciate the message.
Yes. Yes. A king does not speak more than once. When the king says off with your head, the head will roll. When the kings decree a thing, it is such. And so when you understand your kingly nature, what you speak is like abracadabra. I create as I speak. That's what that means, abracadabra. It's like saying open sesame. It happens because you said it. And once you say it, you can move on to something else. Like mama. When mama says something, if she says, wash those dishes. She's going about her business. Don't let her come back in the kitchen 3 hours later and the dishes not washed. There's a price to be paid, right? And so you have to understand your word is like that in the universe. But then you're going to be mature. The maturity is this, that we don't let the lust of the flesh, the eyes, the sensory realm dictate what we want. We have a balance, okay? Because some of the things that we may call into our lives get in the way of our destiny, get in the way of what we're called here to actually do, be, or have. Some things you just don't need. Like I was driving down the street yesterday, last night, and this huge vehicle came next to mine. It was awesome. It was a Rolls Royce. And I would say, wow. And you know, the egotistical self would say, I would like to have one of those. Then I say, I don't, at the point in my life, how my life is showing up right now, where I'm living, what I'm called to do, I don't need the Rolls Royce. Sometimes it's good to just look at something and say, that's nice. Or even the daydream of what it would be like and leave it right there. Being grateful for where you are. You know, and just saying, I'm driving a hoopty right now. I love my hoopty. It get me from point A to point B. No, I'm not driving a hoopty, but I'm saying somebody might say that. But then even saying a hoopty, you're not really celebrating what you have. You're diminishing it. You know, treat your hoopty as it is the thing you hope to have. Treat your hoopty as it is the thing you hope to have. Watch it happen. Treat your current relationship the way you want the next one to be. Treat your current employer like you treated him or her when you first came on board. You may be on your way out, but you don't have to go out nasty. You don't have to go out raggedy. Go out the right way because you're going to take that same energy into your new job. I hope I answered that question. Thanks, Courtney, for sharing that. Awesome. All right. Is there anything else?
We have one more comment from Faye Short, not a question, but it's so powerful. It said, God is ceaseless flow of substance, and no matter what the extent of the need, universal substance can easily supply.
Come on now.
That's come what on I say. Come on, Faye.
That's coming out of New York City. I know she's speaking on behalf of her husband, Ken, gave her that. Thanks, Ken, for giving that to your wife that she could type that in into the platform there. Now, I thank you for sharing that with us this morning, Sister Faye. See, this is some powerful stuff. You're more powerful than you realize. All I am this morning is a catalyst. I'm not telling you something. I have not told any of you anything you didn't already know. I affirm for you what you have heard. Now be great, be powerful. Show up with the brilliance, with the resonance that's required to attract into your life those people. And know this, sometimes you're going to attract some people into your life and you may say, well, I'm not on that vibration. No, you're not on their vibration. But guess what? They tuned in and tapped in to the vibration they saw in you, though they couldn't stay on your vibration. And as Abraham Hicks would say, as she would say, they get thrown out of your vortex, let them go. But you just keep shining, keep being you. Be present to today. Thank you for your time. Awesome.
You have one more hand raised last minute. That's Tony Akers. I'm going to unmute Tony.
Hey, that's one of my peers. Pastor Tony Aker. Good morning.
All right, Tony, you should be permitted to talk. Are you there?
I'm here. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, you got another grandchild.
That's not me.
That's my little one.
Okay.
Well, hi. Awesome. Good morning, everyone. I wanted to say to you, Pastor Greg, one thing that you said this morning that really resonated with me is stop playing small. You know, I had a non-for-profit organization before, so I have a tendency to always want to give my services away for free. And I've been trained on a lot of different healing modalities, and people call me, they're sick, and they're like, well, I can't afford this, I can't afford that. And I'm like, oh, okay, I'll do it for free. And come to find out the same people will spend $1,500 on weed, $500 on a new purse, or whatever the case may be. And God brought it to my attention to stop playing small. I did a health consultation yesterday for a person, and the same thing came out of my mouth. Oh, I'll do it for free. She rebuked me. She said, no, God specifically told me to give you $300. I was like, whoa.
Right. Right, right.
So this is definitely the word was for me. You know, it's okay to be charitable, but for what God has given me, I do need to put a price on my time and on my information. So thank you for that reassurance.
Don't go anywhere. The word of God says, iron sharpens iron. So does one man sharpen the countenance of his friend. Now, some of you may ask, who do I sharpen myself against? Pastor Tony is someone I've known for the last, I think I about since 2011 or something of that sort. And she's clearly a woman of God, very expansive in her thinking. Just kind of shocked me because I thought she was in the traditional mold. But I have really been able to rub up against her and get sharpened. So I want to take this opportunity because she has taken the stance that she's not going to give herself away and allow people to use her. To Tony, if you can share with us either your website, if you could put it in the feed there, or how could people reach out to you?
Right now, they could just call me direct because I'm still building my site. Because I'm, like I said, I'm getting out of that free mode. But right now, they can call me at 773-206-6449. And again, that's 773-206-6449. And can I take one moment to give a testimony from what happened to me this week?
You sure
would can. That be okay? I had a friend. And this is in the realm of healing. I had a friend of mine who had been sick for 3 years with stomach pain. And I called her last week, and that's why I wasn't on the call last week. I called her thinking it was going to be just a quick health and wellness check-in and say, hey, I hadn't heard from you in a while. She said, I just got out of the hospital. I said, what were you doing in the hospital? She said, I've been having these abdominal pains, but the doctors cannot figure out what it is. And they just sent me home after 5 days. I say, why don't I do a quantum frequency scan on you? I have a scanner that does quantum frequencies, and it from your picture, your voice, your face, it tells me what's going on in your body from head to toe. So I scanned her within 15 minutes. I say, you have a bacteria in your colon that's causing inflammation, that's causing pain. All you need to do is take some tea tree and some oregano essential oils, and that pain should go away. 20 minutes later, we're still just talking and shooting the breeze. She just started screaming in my ear. I'm like, what's wrong? She said, my pain is gone. My pain is literally gone. She said, whatever you got, whatever God got you, it is priceless. She said, I've been sick for 3 years with this pain. And you quickly told me that I had bacteria in my colon. My pain is gone. She said, girl, she said, you need to really get this information out to the masses. So, and more testimonies are coming in like that with the technology God has given me. So I'm very blessed by it. And again, I'm reasonable, but I'm not going to give it away anymore.
Right. You don't even have to qualify with reasonable. You just put it out there, because I don't know the last time I went to see a doctor and asked, was his prices reasonable? When you want something, matter of fact, now I'm at the place of purchasing this home. I did ask what they paid for it. I had my realtor do some research to find out what they paid for it. And I see that they're asking only $12,000 over what they paid for it, because clearly this person must have had to get out of town. The place is immaculate. I could move in today if I had the keys. But I said to myself, okay, what should I offer that person? And Spirit says, give them full price. And so, so I asked my loan officer. He says to me, money ain't an issue for you. Looking at what you make and what you have, that's not an issue. So my loan closing has nothing to do with my money. So that was reassuring to know. So here's why I say, give people what they ask. Because when you are delivering a service, you want to be compensated what you ask. When I sell this condo in 3 to 5 years or whenever, I want to be clear that because I paid full price at this time, whoever purchased it at that time will pay full price. But if I finagle with them, look what happens. somebody's going to finagle with me. And that's what some of you are out there that got a product or a service that you're rendering and you are allowing people to finagle your price. No, if you feel in your heart of hearts before the conversation that you should gift them a gift, notice I say G-I-F-T and not G-I-V-E. Giving is, you're never supposed to give your gift away. You can gift it. And if you feel someone can should receive it as a gift, cool. But if you have a price point that is set, stand in the mirror and deliver your price point and be comfortable saying, they're going to ask you, how much is it? You don't have to beat around the bush. It's $5.99. Mm-hmm. And if they want to know what value, what they get, be able to tell them what they get for the $5.99. But don't automatically go into, I got to shift my price down. Don't block your sale. So in the upcoming weeks, I want to have a conversation with you, Tony, on a Tuesday night to explore. Let's talk about healing. Let's talk about different modalities of healing. I operate inside of the mind science of healing without anything, but everybody's not there. Most of us live in a material world, so we need some type of material thing to expedite that healing. It could be a pill. It could be a
lifestyle change.
So let's have that. Matter of fact, let's just get on the calendar for not this Tuesday, but next Tuesday. We'll get together and I'll get the advertisement out to the community so that they can engage you and we go from there. How about that?
That would be wonderful.
Awesome. That's Pastor Tony Akers. She goes by Tony. And I look forward to getting that information out to you all. Well,